Start today's session. I just want to understand if everybody is able to see the screen properly and listen to my voice clearly. If you can just type in yes in the chat box, that'll give us a confirmation. Thank you. All right, great. I think many people have responded with a yes message. All right, great. Okay, so we are starting in another 1 minute. Just so that everybody settles down, we'll start in at 11 o'clock, which is the scheduled time. For those of you who are not aware of the Zoom application, this particular platform has a chat box which you can use. If you have any questions, you can type down your questions and we'll be really happy to address them. Secondly, if you have anything specific to ask to the speaker, you can always raise your hand. There is again an option called raising a hand and you can possibly talk to the speaker as well. All right, so now that it's 11 o'clock, I believe we should start the session now. This session is right now live streamed on YouTube as well. So if there is any participant who is unable to view this session properly on Zoom platform, you can always switch to the YouTube platform and you can watch it over there. Good morning, everyone. My name is Manish Nair. I work with the operations team of 3Dexter for the past four and a half years, I have been associated with the same company. Today, we are going to deliver a presentation on 3D printing technology and how this technology can be useful, can be used in the footwear industry. So for today's presentation, I would like to, just a minute, I have just got a couple of options on my screen. Okay. All right, so I'd like to invite one of our speakers who has extensively given a lot of sessions that are related to 3D printing and some niche industries in particular, be it food industry. The particular speaker that we have today has got a significant students, professors, and much like other people from the academics. So we have Mr. Anand Kumar Mishra, who works as a senior product trainer with 3Dexter Education. And he will take us through the complete process of 3D printing and how this technology can be used in footwear designing. So without further delay, I would like Anand to take over. Just to make sure everything goes fine, I will be in the backend. So if any one of you is facing an issue, you can just type the query on the chat box and I will be available to address your query. Right. With that note, Anand, please take over. Thank you.
Thank you, Manish, sir. I hope I'm audible to everyone. If I'm audible, please use the chat box to reply. All right, that's great. I've got confirmation over here. A lot of confirmation. Okay, thank you for that. Thank you. So a very good morning to everyone. And I hope this session gives you a lot of knowledge regarding 3D printing in the footwear industry. So let's start the session. What are we actually going to learn today? So these are the agenda. So basically we will learn the basics of 3D printing and how it is being actually used in the footwear industry. I will be also giving you a glimpse about how to use this technology. I will be showing you a designing software. I will be showing also a glimpse of the slicing software. and a huge surprise for all of you. We have a printer with you, using which we will be showing you live printing process also. All right. So sit together, everyone. So let's start the meeting. So we 3 Dexter are a training company. Basically, we provide training to the people throughout India regarding 3D printing. It has been more than 4 years since we are been doing that. In the meanwhile, we have also started manufacturing our own 3D printers. Okay, they are good quality printers, and we do the training using these printers. It is an FDM based printers. I will be telling you that what FDM actually means, and it has been huge successful, and we are a leading edtech company actually in the current scenario. Now moving forward around myself, my name is Anand Kumar Mishra. As sir has told, I have been associated with the company 3 Dexter Education from the past 3.5 years. So basically I take up sessions regarding additive manufacturing and design thinking. There are a lot of philosophical approaches to problem solving and all. I take up those as well as the technical part. All right. So let's see. Let's enter our session today. All right. Now, the footwear industry that we are all looking into today, it is a very, very old scenario. Now, we have been utilizing the shoe from a long, long time ago. We wear shoe for protection purpose. Now, if you see the slide right now, you can see a lot of development have been occurred in the design as well as the material that has been used for the manufacturing of the shoe. You can, the common names of shoe, it may, we can call it a slipper, a shoe, a sandal, whatever you may call, but footwear. Okay. I am summarizing all of them together in footwear. Okay. Now see, in the beginning of time, you see the footwear designs were very vague, and the, they were just made up of the materials which are easily available to the nomads out there. Okay. Now, as the technology or the invention started, the designing things, the innovative ideas, it got involved over the manufacturing process, and the quality of the shoes, it started improving. All right. You see the designing, the intricacies, you can also feel it over there. Now, another thing is, not only it is showing protection or it is providing protection, but also there the shoe also represented the social status of a person. Okay, like in the Roman Empire, different status people wore different shoes. Okay, now they had insignia over their shoe. All right. These are the a lot of advantages they had. They can represent the status of the person. They are actually representing the work the person is doing, right? These are the things that are actually showcased through a shoe. Now, this is what I was talking about. This is the Roman footwear. So basically, it was a this image is of a soldier, okay, who was on foot. Okay, a foot soldier, this is the footwear that has been used. All right. Now, in the left-hand image, you can see the comparison with the olden shoe and our modern shoe. See the protection level that is being provided in the modern shoe, it is very, very high. All right. The quality has improved a lot. See, the visual impact provided by the modern shoe is also very, very important. Now, it is also told that whenever we meet a person, we tend to see the first sight that we see is the shoe. It is a common saying that whenever we meet any person, we tend to look into the shoe of the person, right? So this is the impression that a person has, right, about shoes. The quality, the maintenance of the shoe, it actually defines a lot about the person. Now, if we look into the olden scenarios, how shoes were actually manufactured, they were actually done by cobblers. Okay. They used to have a own shop. Now, whenever a person needs a shoe or a footwear, they used to go to the cobbler. They used to give the shape and size of their feet, and the shoe or the footwear would be ready accordingly. Now, this would be termed as customization. All right. Now, as per the requirements of the suppose this is the client, as per the requirement of the client, the shoe will be prepared. Okay, this was what was done in the olden days. So as the industrial process got involved and the development of the shoe became more intricate and more difficult, so we went for mass production of shoes. Okay, now in mass production, what we actually do, we get the standard size of the persons, the standard shoe or a feet size of person, and we create millions of shoe using that standard size, right? Now, suppose there is one design, and from one design, we create almost a million of the shoes, right? A variety of shoes available of the same size of different designs that we can do through mass production, okay? Now, the thing is, whenever we go to a shop now, there will be ready-made shoes available, and we buy whichever one we like the most. Okay, we do not have a choice about like whichever design I want. Now, this is not possible in mass production. All right. Now, how does mass production is actually be done? Through the help of molds. Okay, this is being done through the help of molds or the casting method. All right, the raw material that we have, we used to pour it inside this mold cavities, and the final output is actually ready within seconds. Okay, I would really say that this foot manufacturing technique through molds, it is really fast, and it can be within a day, a huge number of shoes can be actually manufactured, and it is being done actually, right? Because it is known as mass manufacturing. Mass production, all right. Now, these molds that you are actually seeing, they are actually costly. Now, suppose I want the company wants to change the design of the shoe. Okay, suppose the company wants to change the design of simply the not the complete shoe, just the sole purpose. Sole. Now, if you see, if I have to change the design of the sole by only 10%. I have to completely change the mold, right? I have to use a completely new design or a new mold material for creating a new design. So this is a huge cost burden. I have to invest a lot of capital actually, right? Because molds are not easily available. It takes time to create a mold. Okay, it is also time taking. Also, it will be taking up a lot of capital also. Okay, this is a disadvantage of mold. Now, moving forward about the process. Now, we will be creating the soles of the shoe through a mold. Now, this is a GIF image. All right. Now, what happens is, in this GIF image, you are seeing the left-hand side, the sole is being made. All right. And the right-hand side, you see the stitching is being done through the machines. Okay, once the soles are made through these molds, it is a very fast process, and within minutes the cooling is also done and our soles are ready. The same way, the stitching of the shoes are also done in a very mechanized way in mass production, and in a day many number of shoes are actually produced. All right, now this is how the traditional way of shoe making is being done nowadays. Now, let's look at the special requirement of some person. Okay, in the image that you are seeing, she is an athlete. Her name is Swapna, and she has won a Asian gold medal. So she has an issue with her feet. She has 6 number of toes in her feet. All right. Now, regular shoes do not actually fit her. Okay, regular shoes, they do not actually fit her. Now, she has to actually go through a lot of pain while wearing those shoes. Now, as she has to actually go do customization, so what happened is Adidas, they took her from India to Germany. Okay, in Germany, they did the scanning of the feet. They took all the data from her feet and they made a customized shoe for her. Okay, this is actually an example of customization. All right, this is the need of the hour, that is the customization. So our main focus would be how 3D printing can actually help all about customization. All right, now. So basically I gave a brief introduction about what is the present scenario of the footwear industry, how the molds are used and how costly actually it is, because we have to replace every time the molds, we have to give a certain amount of money for creating a new mold. All right, now let's look into 3D printing. As the session today is about 3D printing, let's look into 3D printing first. Now in this image, there are two things you can see. Suppose the final product is this. All right. And in the lower portion, lower image also, this is the final product. All right. There are two ways through which we can manufacture it. First is the subtractive method. Now we have a tool over here. And this tool is actually removing the materials layer by layer. Okay, according to the movement, suppose according to this, there will be a G-code for the movement of this tool, and it is removing the material. Okay, you see the final object is this. So all the layers are removed. Now, one thing you can observe here is we have got a huge block. And from this huge block, we are removing the material. That is why it is known as subtractive. There will be a lot of wastage over here. All right. The wastage may be recycled or it may not be recycled. All right. Now, just below, if I have additive manufacturing process. Okay. 3D printing is also known as additive manufacturing. Now, how it works? We apply the raw material. Okay, the raw material through which our material or the product is being made, we apply it layer by layer. Okay, suppose this is a tool through which we're applying the raw material. You see, the application is being done layer by layer. Okay, there's this initial stages. Next, we have this middle stages, almost half of the model is ready. And then you can see over here, this is the final stage. Okay. So basically this is how it functions. So we are applying the material layer by layer till the final product is ready. So what happens over here is actually there is a very minimum amount of wastage of the raw material and the final product is ready in a very faster manner. Now, if you see, one thing is that is known as prototype. Okay, the first product that a company makes for testing purpose, it is known as prototype. Like we have heard about the beta version of softwares, they launch the beta version of software for testing purpose, right? In the same way, in the mechanical world, we create prototypes for testing purpose. All right, so prototyping is easily done through additive manufacturing. Okay, that is why it is also known as rapid prototyping. All right. So what is the simple process? A very simple language to understand what it actually means, 3D printing. The steps involved is we will first create a digital file. Okay, we will be using a CAD software or any other software. So basically a CAD file is to be created, computer aided design file is to be created, whichever requirement we have. Okay. We will create a design. After that, what we do, we will be converting the file, transferring the file to a slicing software. As you see in this image, this model, okay, this is the final object. So this model is actually made up of slices. Okay, individual layers. All right, so basically there has to be software which would actually convert the whole model into individual slices. right? This has to be actually done. All right. Now, once we have got the data in the form of slices, we transfer the data in the form of G code to a 3D printer. So what the printer would actually do, it will start printing. Now we all must have seen a 2D printer, the one which printers on a page. All right, that is a 2D printer. Now while printing, it has got a length and a breadth. But in 3D printer, what happens is it has also got a third dimension, that is height. All right. So basically, you see, this is a nozzle. This is an FDM based printer that I'm going to show you today. There is two different nozzles. Okay. This part is aluminum block. This is a brass nozzle. And this is how the object has been created. Okay. The fingertips is being printing right now. All right. So this is how 3D printing is done. Suppose, giving this example, someone must have created the design of this hand or the fingers, and in computer, we will be created a design file. We will transfer the file to the slicing software. We will create individual layers and we'll transfer the individual layer data to the printer. So basically the printer will move according to the G code that we created in the slicing software. All right, everyone. Now, in this image, you see the first process that involves in 3D printing is we create a CAD model, as I told you. CAD. CAD means computer aided design. Okay. It can be any random design you can create. It has to be whatever design you make, it can be 3D printed. So there is no restriction in the type of design you can make. All right. Now, after that, what we actually do is we transfer the file or convert the file into an STL format. Okay. STL means standard triangulation language or standard tessellation language. So basically the surface data of this model, the surface data means the coordinates of the location of the surface and all the points, they are actually converted to the form of a triangles, and the surface data is stored. Okay, no material data and all is stored, only the surface data is stored in the form of triangles, and we transfer this STL file, okay, to the slicing software. All right, now individual layers are to be actually created in this slicing software. Like, see, this is slicer layers, individual layers will be created. Now in this software, it will create a G code. Now according to our printer, so whichever printer we are using, we have to give the settings accordingly. Whichever hardwares we are actually using, we have to give all the data actually. And according to the printer, suppose there are different materials actually for 3D printing. So we have to enter the data correctly, which material we are using, what is the temperature to print, all this data we have to enter, and we create a G code. That G code, I will be putting that to a 3D printer to print actually. Okay, so according to the G code, okay, according to the G code, our 3D printer will work and our printed object will be created. Okay, so basically the G code that we created, it will be getting all the data, like the motion of the printer, the tool head motion, okay, the material temperature, melting temperature, all the data is actually connected in the G code. Okay, this is the very important stage. Now, after that, the final object, once it is created, now it is not completed, the final object. So it has to actually go through a lot of post-processing techniques. Okay, basically what happens is there will be a lot of supports, a lot of different materials is there. Like we may need a good quality finishing also. Okay, we have to grind it. We have to file it to some extent to get a better quality finishing. Okay, that has to be done in the post-processing stage. Now, let's look at an overview about additive manufacturing. The different terms that can be used in additive manufacturing is rapid prototyping. The rapid prototyping, as I told you, prototype is the object that is actually created for testing. The first object that is actually created by the company for testing purpose, okay? That is known as prototype. Now, 3D printing is known as rapid prototyping. So basically, by going through the traditional manufacturing process, as I told you, to create a prototype, we have to first make a mold. Now, mold making is a long process. It is a very costly process. It will take a lot of time. All right. Now, 3D printing is rapid prototyping. As you see, we do not require any kind of mold. We are creating the object layer by layer. The prototype can actually be created in a very fast manner. The time consumption is very low. That is the reason why it is known as rapid prototyping. All right. Now, another technique, the terminology used here is direct digital manufacturing. Digital manufacturing means we are actually converting a digital file actually into, we are converting a digital file. All right. We are converting a digital file into a real life object. Okay. It is just like a magic. We are converting it into a real life object. So that is why it is known as direct digital manufacturing. All right. Other names are layered manufacturing, as it is being done through layer by layer, and additive fabrication. All right. So all of them are a part of Industry 4.0. We will talk about that in the later stage also. All right. So basically, additive manufacturing is an appropriate name to describe the technologies that build 3D objects by adding layer upon layer of material, whether the material is plastic, metal, concrete, or even human tissue. Now, the thing that I saw is the process that I just showed you, it was about layer by layer addition of material. Okay, now that is the process. Now there are different technologies that are actually available for 3D printing. The raw material can be plastic, it can be metal, it can be concrete, or even human tissue. Okay, now let me show you a few examples regarding this. All right, now let's look into this. Now the first thing that I want to show you is let's go to the architecture field and look about this example. All right. So the first sector that actually I showed you was from the architectural field. Now you see this was a house that was actually 3D printed in Russia. Now the present live example that I can tell you is just when this COVID-19 situation started in Wuhan. So they had very less amount of restriction area or the isolation areas. So they used the 3D printing technique to actually create homes for not only hospitals but also isolation wards for the people. Okay, they created 3D printed homes for isolation ward. Now let's look into another way. Okay, the another industry I would show you is this automobile industry.
I'm James Earl with Local Motors, and we're 3D printing the car.
In Cincinnati, Ohio, this industrial-sized 3D printer is in the process of making the shell of an electric car.
The model that we're building is called Strati. The entire design and build process of the vehicle, from our idea stage in May of this year to printing a car out in September, is only 4 months. A traditional vehicle can take years to do the same thing.
In 2013, a car known as the Urbee by Core Ecologic became the first vehicle to have a 3D printed body. It took about 2,500 hours to print. The Strati by Local Motors took just 44 hours to print at a trade show in Chicago. For these upstarts, it's all about efficiency.
Versus traditional manufacturing, so they take a big piece of metal and machine it down to get a small piece out. And usually their buy-to-fly ratio is 20 to 1. They have to buy 20 pounds more material than they get out of it at the end, out of their usable part at the end. To us, it's very, very close to 1. We only put in as much material as we need. We'll machine off a little bit around the outside, but it's almost 1, which reduces costs overall because you're not wasting all that material.
Local Motors is taking the chassis, seats, door panels, and thousands of other components and 3D printing all those parts into just one piece made of a strong filament consisting of carbon fiber and ABS plastic. Drive components like the engine and wheels are added in later.
A 3D printed car like ours will only have dozens of components versus a traditional car which could have thousands or tens of thousands of components. So each one of those components has a tendency for something to go wrong. You have the risk of something to fail. And by reducing the overall complexity, you increase the longevity of your car overall.
Earl estimates that in the near future, a 3D printed car like the Strati could feasibly cost just $7,000 to manufacture. Despite this low cost, major automakers won't be making the jump from the assembly line to mass producing 3D printed cars anytime soon.
Difficulty there is you're really only producing one vehicle at a time. And traditionally, their factories now, they're producing hundreds of vehicles a day, but they're working on hundreds of vehicles at a time instead of what we're doing, one vehicle at a time. So it's hard to see in the next 10 or 20 years that that's going to happen. But at the same time, the technology is expanding exponentially. So in 20 years, there may be an entirely new way of 3D printing that is quicker and faster than the way that they're making cars now.
Rick Neff of Cincinnati Incorporated, the maker of the actual printer used by Local Motors, agrees.
I don't think that this technology is going to basically take over what General Motors or Ford is doing today. But I think that Local Motors can have a nice small market segment for mass customized cars, maybe at a premium price that this machine would be fabulous for.
Major automakers have long been taking advantage of 3D printing for design and prototyping in particular. Ford is saving nearly $500,000 in months of production time with just one 3D printed prototype part.
Well, the reason why 3D printing is so revolutionary is because things that you used to be able to make years ago with hours and hours of processes can now be made very quickly. And you can get something that you can hold in your hand to represent a part, or you can actually put it on a final product and use it.
For the rest of us, the benefits of 3D printing are limited only by our imaginations.
This process will allow consumers to really customize the vehicle that they want. Instead of going to a dealership and buying a car that they may make a couple different versions of, but is essentially the same vehicle as they made several hundred thousand of, you can make a vehicle for yourself. It's basically one off. Do the entire design, everything like that if you'd like to. Or we could have other customizable parts where you could go in and mold the car to fit you. So you take a 3D scan of your body and you could create custom fit seats that conform to your shape. Things like that that you couldn't do with cars now.
Yeah. All right, so this is what I was telling. The thing is, a lot of industries are actually using this. Okay, a lot of industries has adapted to this technology, that is additive manufacturing technologies. Not only in prototyping, but also the final thing. All right. As I told you, as the video just showed, like the prototyping or the main material that was created, the usage of the raw material is very, very less. Okay. The comparison made was by going through the traditional manufacturing of the cars, they use 20 times more raw materials if they want to create a single product. Now, in 3D printing, we can create it. The ratio is almost 1:1. Okay, the raw material that we require, we are completely using that. All right. So the huge advantage here that I want to show you is these designs. Okay, these are the designs that I am talking about. Now, these designs are to the left. I have a lattice structure. Now, it cannot actually be used for 3D. Traditional manufacturing. This object, it cannot be created by traditional manufacturing method, and it has to be done through 3D printing. All right. The same way to the right hand side, you have this image. Now this is not, and we have topologically optimized this object. All right, this structure, we have topologically optimized it, and the final product is this. All right, now what happens is this structure, after topological optimization, this is the weight has been reduced to a lot, and the material which is available, it is located in the place wherever there is a stress induced. All right, so the weight, we have a huge advantage of this design. Now the problem is we cannot 3D print, manufacturing this object through traditional method. So for this kind of structure, we have to actually go for additive manufacturing technologies. All right, so this is what happens. So the more the complex the design is, we have to approach the additive manufacturing process. Now, this is the first image that I wanted to show you about the 3D printed shoe. Now, if you observe very carefully, there are a different variety of lattice structure in the front part. You see, this is the different lattice structure. In the middle portion, there is a different lattice structure. And in the sole portion, you see, there is a different lattice structure. All right. Now, this can be actually achieved through 3D printing. All right. This is a huge advantage of 3D printing, that a lot of complex design can actually be made only through this. All right, we will look into this method also, how this shoe was actually made. We will look into that also. So that is a part of today's session. So the most important thing that 3D printing caters to is mass customization. Okay, now every person has a desire to get his or her own design. All right, they have an idea in mind. Suppose now in the present scenario, what is actually happening is, suppose we want a shoe. What we do, we go to the shop, we get to select whatever is there in the rack. Now, suppose think it in this way, whenever we go to a shop, suppose we get to get the option to give our ideas or our design to the shopkeeper, and the shopkeeper is 3D printing our shoe. So our design, we are getting it 3D printed and the shoe is ready. So that is known as customization. According to the requirement of the user, we will get a product. Now the target now is mass customization. Now the present scenario is such that we are trying, 3D printing is able to cater the customization of every customer, but it is a little time taking, and the main aim for 3D printing right now is mass customization. Okay. Now let's move forward and why it is actually important now. So why 3D printing has got a huge market share actually now. Okay. The thing is the growing consumer demand for personalized product. Now, not only 3D printing. Now see, whenever we gift someone any product, we tend to see that we tend to give a personalized product. Okay. So the requirement of the customer is basically customized, so that they have a connection with the product they are making. All right. So that is the main requirement. So basically customized product will have the specifically tailored requirements as per the wearer. This is for the shoe industry. All right. Now in the shoe industry, the aim is to get a mass customization scenario. That is our target, right? We can create specifically tailored shoe for the wearer. The main aim is to get mass customization. All right. Now, another thing is now we are in industry 4.0. So the requirement now is mostly about digital manufacturing. All right. Now, the advantage of digital manufacturing is, as I just showed you, optimization of the manufacturing process. There is a very high chance the material utilized is actually reduced to a huge extent. The weight of the final produce is getting reduced as there is a lot of hollow spaces. And most important thing is there is a reduction of specialized machine and manual labor. Okay. In traditional method that we just saw from mold mechanism, we have to invest a lot to the specialized machines and all those materials and all the production line, but it can be reduced to a large extent. All right. So let's look at final video about how 3D printing is actually being used. Okay. An Indian example. Okay, that I would like to give now.
Guru Nanak Dev Engineering College was started in 1956. Manufacturing Research Lab was started in 2012. Dr. H.S. Vedi contacted us. So he wanted a 3D image of this lung of that patient.
My patient was a 23-year-old young man. His parents told me that he had been blue and there was this mass where the blood was recirculating. That's called an arteriovenous malformation. An X-ray and a CT scan is a two-dimensional.
For converting that particular SICOM images to the STL file, and those files were actually printed in the SC UPrint 3D printer.
I'll show you the print. So this is the 3D print. And all these branches are exactly as they are in the body, because I could not see through the blood, through the lung. And this was actually present in our operation theater. So it just took us, I think, about 1.5 hours, something which would have taken 4 hours. Because again, we had an absolute knowledge of where the artery is. The blood loss was next to nil. This was a great boon to us. Within 2 days, we were able to send him home. And his nails, you will see, are absolutely pink now. So hats off to technology.
So, alright, so that was how 3D printing is actually utilized in the medical industries also. Now, as the doctor said, they got reduction in the operation time and there was huge reduction in the blood loss. So, this product was actually helping the doctor to reduce the complexity while operating. Okay. Now, this one is example from India. Now, let's see the 3D printing technologies that are actually used in the footwear industries. Okay. As I told you, we create G-code. We have to create the model layer by layer through the G-codes. Let's look into the technologies used in the footwear industry. The first is the material extrusion. All right. The first is the material extrusion process. Now, what happens here is the raw material. Okay. As the image, you can see the raw material is in the form of a wire. So this wire is going inside this print head or a nozzle. So here the raw material has to be heated up to a certain melting point and the print head would move according to the motion of the G-code. All right. And the material would be deposited layer by layer. All right. So you see, this is the final object and it is being created by depositing layer by layer. Okay. This is how this method actually works. Now, in footwear industry, it is known as solid deposit modeling. You see, this is a nozzle over here. So basically from this nozzle is actually heated up and from this nozzle, the melted part, okay, the raw material is melted and it is coming out in the form of liquid. And according to the motion of this print head part, there will be deposition. All right. Now, after each layer has been created, the print head actually goes up and another layer is deposited. All right. This is how it is known as additive manufacturing. It is simply like melting the raw material and depositing it layer by layer. Now, in material extrusion, there is also another method. Just we saw what you say. The car was manufactured. There it was the raw material was not in the form of wire, but in the form of pellets. Okay. So in there, what happens is we have a container. We melt the pellets in the container and through injection process. Okay. We apply pressure and through the pressure, applying the pressure, the liquid, once it is melted, it will come out from the nozzle. Okay. There's a plunger system. All right. That will also be coming under material extrusion process. Now, many prototypes are actually created through material extrusion because it is very cheap and it is easy to handle. So a lot many of prototypes are actually created through this method. All right. Now let's do the example. Okay. Now see, in the image you are seeing, this is a shoe of designed by Nike. Okay. The upper parts have been 3D printed. Okay. This yellowish greenish part, you see, this has been 3D printed. The upper part is completely 3D printed. All right. Now, companies like Nike, Adidas, they are investing a lot in 3D printing technology so that they can actually create something that is completely different, which is not available actually in the market. All right. See, this is being done completely through 3D printing, the upper parts. Now, moving to this one. this is a shoe. Okay, the red color straps that you see over here, this has actually 3D printed. Okay, this part is actually 3D printed. Okay, now even Reebok is investing into this. So let me show you this video, how the 3D printing is actually done. So let's go and watch about a video on Reebok.
The footwear industry is seeing a jumpstart in technology. Nike's HyperAdapt made self-lacing shoes a reality. Adidas's Futurecraft introduced 3D printing with comfort. And now Reebok's Liquid Factory is making intricate, lightweight designs along with the company's 100% recyclable footwear line, Cotton and Corn.
This is our 3D printing lab.
Bill McGinnis is head of Reebok Future.
Liquid Factory is a way to get away from using molds like every other shoe in the market does, and draw the bottom of the shoe instead. So this is like 3D printing, only much, much faster.
It's an effort to streamline production and keep up with younger consumers.
The big goal is to go from, we're going to make 1 million pairs of one shoe in the exact same type and hope everybody likes it, and that was kind of the old model, and now we're moving to smaller and batches. Instead of a tighter and tighter, you can get closer and closer to custom.
And how is that a benefit to Reebok? What are the benefits of new manufacturing?
So you can get a lot faster, so you can react much more quickly to consumers.
Reebok isn't alone. Parent company Adidas and rivals Nike and Under Armour have also moved into the 3D printed sneaker game. But Reebok's Liquid Factory material is proprietary. The process uses computer software and robotics to draw shoes in three dimensions.
We're actually faster than the old model right now. So each bottom unit takes a couple minutes to put together. And again, it's all automated.
Adidas bought Reebok in 2006 for $3.8 billion, and in 2010 began a turnaround to reposition it as a fitness brand by signing a partnership with CrossFit. But Reebok today is the one unit that remains unprofitable. Still, Adidas says it's committed to the future of Reebok and moved its headquarters from the Boston suburbs to downtown this year.
The spirit of the company has changed dramatically. I mean, we were always a very established shoe brand. Moving down here, being in the excitement of this district, I think has the whole place feeling like a startup.
It does feel like a startup, breathing new life into its classic white leather sneaker. Anne Mostu, Bloomberg, Boston.
So the process that you actually saw, that was actually FDM technologies, all right? Now SDM, solid deposit modeling. So this was actually deposited layer by layer, all right? This product was created by adding layer by layer. You could actually see the plunger over there, the liquid material was deposited, all right? This was the technology. Using that technology, this was created, all right? Now, another company is out there, which involves Prevolve. Okay, now the thing is, these are completely recyclable materials they used for 3D printing. All right, there is a movement known as free footwear. Okay, so basically they are creating this shoe according to the custom fit. So as per the requirements of the person's feet, this has been created and they are completely recyclable. This is being done completely through FDM method. Okay, the method that I just showed you, this method. All right. So this is involving the company Prevolve. Now the next thing that I would talk about, which material are we actually using? Okay, through this method, that is material extrusion. We have a heated nozzle or a plunger system. So basically we are using TPU. Okay, polyurethane. All right, now you see the main property over here. It is highly flexible over here. The basic example that you get is whoever is using a mobile phones, they have a mobile cover. All right, the mobile covers, they are actually made up of TPU. Okay, you can actually feel the flexibleness of this mobile cover. Now, which parts are actually manufactured? The part that is upper parts mostly. In this image, you are seeing the upper parts. It has been made through that FDM method. All right. Now, while going to the other methods, you can see the different 3D printing techniques are there and different parts are how they are actually made. The second 3D printing technique that are actually utilized in food industry is this VAT photopolymerization method. Now, what it is, we have a raw material that is completely liquid. Okay, we have a tank. Inside the tank, we put the raw material that is a liquid. We call the liquid as resin. It is a photopolymer material which reacts to the UV light. As soon as it comes in contact with the UV light, what happens? It gets converted into solid. So that is known as curing. C-U-R-I-N-G, curing. All right. Now, there are two methods. One is stereolithography and another is CDLP, continuous digital light processing. Now, CDLP is a very faster process. And as I told you, the individual layers, they have to be actually focused on the surface and our complete object will be created. All right. So this is how it works. So individual layers, they are converted into solid. The bed plate will go up and another layer will be created. All right. So it is being done layer by layer. All right. This is how CDLP actually works. Okay. Now the advantage over here is any number of complexity can be made through this. You see the complex shape over here in the top right portion. The lattice has been made in a very complex way. Okay. This can be created through this method, CDLP method. Okay, you can see the size of the object over here is very small, similar to the coin, but there are a lot of intricacies over there. Okay, this can be done through this method, VAT photopolymerization method. So now, shoes which are actually created, which has a very different variety of soles, okay, different lattice structure, they are actually made through this method. You see, there's a tank, and inside tank, we have a liquid resin. All right, this is the final product. So just below it, we will be focusing the layers, CDLP method, and our product will go up. This is a bed plate, it will go up once it has been solidified. Now, this is what I was talking about. This image is from the shoe of the Form Labs. This part is actually 3D printed. Okay, a very complex part, it's been 3D printed. So let's see how it has been actually done.
Back now with what could be the future of footwear. What if you could walk into an athletic store, have your feet scientifically mapped, and walk out with a sneaker that has been perfectly customized for your foot?
Sounds pretty good, and that is the concept behind a brand new pair of shoes resulting from a collaboration between Adidas and tech company Carbon. Joseph DeSimone is Carbon's co-founder and CEO, and Olympic gold medalist Tori Bowie is a track and field athlete sponsored by Adidas and a legend. Good morning to
Hi
both
guys.
Of you.
Hi, guys. Good morning.
So how does this work? So this is a 3D printer. You're kind of molding the shoe
That's
to
right.
our foot?
That's right. So this midsole for this shoe, the Futurecraft 4D, was made on a printer very similar to this, and we're printing something that's very similar to this midsole in real time. This is going to be about 6 minutes, and we can make really complex structures tailored to individual people.
Now, you're teaming up with Adidas on this. Why can't they do that without a 3D printer?
Because the comfort and strike zone of how you walk, I mean, you don't want a standard size 9. You want a shoe for Matt or Savannah or Tori.
Right.
And so to take individual data, use mathematics to design a shoe specifically for an individual, and it's finishing in real time.
Tori, you're wearing a pair of these. Does it feel different from other shoes you've worn in the past?
Yes, of course it does. They feel absolutely amazing. I mean, they're tailored just to fit my feet.
Do you feel like it would give you an advantage?
Yes, it gives me an extra boost, an extra bounce, some more energy, and I mean, I think this is our future right here.
Can we take the tight shot of this? Because this one has now been completed, and it basically was just at the beginning when I walked in this studio.
We print shoes now in tens of minutes, and so what this really means is about quality, speed, and scale. So you can now do this for not just for individual high-performance athletes, but everybody can get a custom shoe.
So is the vision that you go into the shoe store and there's one of these? And you walk out, I mean, minutes later with your custom shoe?
What they do is you go in a store and you get measured.
Okay.
Right? And then within days, they can provide that shoe to you.
Wow.
What else can this technology do?
Well, as we look back here, what you start
what we can do is go beyond footwear. So we'll be making these in the hundreds of thousands and millions and tens of millions. But this technology also lends itself to applications in automotive, in aerospace, lightweight drones, all these kinds of digital parts. I mean, you just think about a part like this, right? It would be hard to fabricate things like this. And this came out of a digital printer.
Wow.
Wow. It's fascinating. By the way, you're also a professor at UNC Chapel Hill, right?
That's right.
Congratulations on the Tar Heels. Yeah. Way to go. Tori, great to see you.
Thank you so much.
What a pleasure.
Thank
you. Appreciate you coming.
Hello, Today fans. Thanks for checking out.
Basically, you could see in that method, that SLA method, they were actually creating the complete shoe. Okay, the midsole of the shoe was 3D printed completely. And as a person said, it was done within tens of minutes, right? Within 10 to 15 minutes, it was ready, the whole midsole. So the technology that was actually being shown in the video is SLA. Okay, there was a, this method, as I told you, we have a raw material, we have a bed plate, and we are focusing the individual layers. All right. Now, another example that I would show now is this. Okay. The image credit goes to Iris Van Herpen. So this is PolyJet 3D printing method. Okay. You can see the complexity that is being utilized here. So this can be only achieved through 3D printing and no other traditional manufacturing method. So this is what I was saying. Even if you go by mold manufacturing, this is not possible. And the complexity, the more the complexity is, the more you have to approach the 3D printing actually. All right. So this was actually shown, showcased during the Paris Fashion Week. All right. You can see that the complexity is then. And the technique that was used is PolyJet 3D printing technique. All right. Now, in this method, that is SLA 3D printing method, the materials that can be actually used, you see, the same, it is a TPU in the resin form. It can be silicone or it can be elastic polyurethane. All right. So the mostly the parts that are actually manufactured is midsoles. In the image, you are seeing three images over here. This is a TPU midsole over here. All right. TPU is highly flexible actually. Next, we have a flexible silicone. So you see the lattice structure. So basically, the shoe performance can be actually substantially improved due to the ability to create midsoles with lattice structures. Okay, this lattice structures is not possible by any other method. Okay, you can see the lattice structure is completely different. So this is how we are creating it in a better way. Okay, we are improving the performance of the shoes. Now the next final method that is actually being used is this powder bed fusion method. Now in this powder bed fusion method, what happens is we can even 3D print metals. Okay, it is may come to a surprise to most of you. Even we can 3D print metals. All right. Now the name that we use for it is selective laser sintering or direct metal laser sintering. So this direct metal laser sintering, it is specifically for metals. And for selective laser sintering, we use either TPU or nylon polyamides. Okay. So the process here we use is the raw material is in the form of powders. If you observe carefully, the raw material is in the form of powder. So what happens is we are depositing the powder on the bed plate. Okay. After one layer of the powder has been deposited, we use a power source. It can be a laser or it can be electron beam. Okay, so this will actually sinter the powder. Okay, it will sinter the powder according to the G code. So the motion of the laser light, it will be according to the G code created in form of raw material. And we sinter them, that is we fuse them together with the help of laser light, okay, laser or electron beam. Now, you can see in this image, most of them is actually metals. Now, moving to the footwear industry, this company, New Balance, it has actually created this part, complete part through this method, SLS method, selective laser sintering. All right, so the complexity you can actually observe through this and the process involved. Okay, so basically we will be creating this design in a software model, the digital file that I would say. After that, what we do, we transfer it to a slicing software, and then we 3D print it. So this is a metallic part. This shoe is metallic. So as I told you, DMLS, direct metal laser sintering, that was done through this. The company involved here is Mycelium. All right. So this is a metallic 3D printed part. And according to the custom fit of the person, it has been made. Right. So the great thing is, as per the customization, any kind of product can be actually created. All right. The material used here will be thermoplastic elastomeric materials. Now, this example that I am showing right now, you can see the lattice structure is open over here. All right. The whole part is actually SLS. The method used is SLS, selective laser sintering. Insoles and midsoles, they are actually created through this. Okay. Now, if you see, now the different, this is completely whole part, whole shoe is completely 3D printed over here, this image. All right. Now, through this black, the lady is wearing a black shoe. So this is FDM or SDM method that has been used to create the whole object. Okay. The complexity, the more the complexity, the more approach is towards 3D printing. All right. The lattice structure are actually involved through this. Okay. So these designs are done through 3D printing. So this is the actually the future. So let me show you a some testimonies. Okay, let's use SLS. We did not see that.
We're here in Baltimore at Under Armour's global headquarters to see if a 3D $300 shoe, the UA Architect.
Let's find out. What led to this particular structure, and how is this going to actually benefit somebody wearing these shoes?
Yeah, this creates a nice dynamic stability platform for the end user. And by the interlacing lattice structures, they actually build into a cam, which is an energy return mechanism. It allows us to do the power rack movements of a weightlifting shoe and also go right into the CrossFit movements without changing the shoes.
I think the next best thing to do is to see one of these shoes actually printed so that later we can go and test it.
Started a job last night, and now we're getting ready to open it up and take the parts out. So right now we're putting this acrylic block. This allows the powder not to spill over. Now we're in a breakout area. The breakout area is where we separate the powder from the actual physical parts. And we can just slowly shake this powder out. The next step is to go to the sandblaster and blow the parts off. We're all done.
Here we are in the Innovation Lab to test out the 3D printed components with machines that simulate the stresses athletes put on the sneakers in the real world. Although Under Armour won't let us wear the shoe, we can certainly test to see if it'll fall apart.
The best way to test the shoe is to really run and jog in it every day. Unfortunately, most people have to sleep, so the ElectroPulse machine allows them to test the shoe unattended.
You can clearly see how springy the Architect is, but there wasn't a whole lot of difference between the shoe and the traditional trainer. Now let's move on to the next test.
One of the biggest stress areas in a shoe is the flex point. This flex testing machine will be testing the durability of that flex point.
We ran through this test a few times, and while we noticed a little pulling at the flex point, it was nothing unusual, because only the midsole of the shoe is 3D printed. Now let's check out the final test.
This is a dynamic impact tester, and it's going to be testing the rebound energy of the shoe. A traditional cross trainer has a lot of springiness, but you're losing out on some stability, which is really important when you're doing weight training. A 3D printed heel component should maintain that springiness while also giving you improved dynamic stability.
Here's where you really see the benefits of a 3D printed midsole. The unique latticework maintains rebound in the heel while providing insane stability. The traditional trainer doesn't do as well. Without the 3D printed latticework, it's bouncing all over the place. And the proof is in the graphs. There's a very clear difference between the two and how they react to having a missile launched at their heel. Calling it the first 3D printed shoe is a bit of an exaggeration. The Architect only uses a 3D printed midsole, which keeps it mostly in line with a traditional trainer. However, the new midsole does show its advantages in adding stability to what would normally be a very bouncy shoe. But despite being a real technological innovation that opens the door for amazing customizability, at $300, this one's best left to the professionals.
So, alright, so that was the video for SLS technology. Okay, the third technology that I showed, that was SLS technology, selective laser sintering. So there you could see the powder was used as the raw material, and that was sintering. Okay, they fused the powder together to get the final product. Okay, now let's look at all the technologies together.
This is Liquid Factory, and this triggers oxygenation of liquid.
But oxygen inhibits it. That allows us to have the object grow.
What's really interesting about this collaboration with carbon is we're seeing a convergence.
When we first started with the idea of Futurecraft, it was to sort of guide us, to set us on a path.
It's a mindset and it's a philosophy to try things.
We're always bringing in new influences, new ideas, new collaborations. 3D printing, for example, was one of these new technologies that really had unlimited possibilities. You know, the initial problem was, okay, can we actually make a running shoe out of 3D printed material that really works and works well?
So when we started thinking about doing 3D printing, we wanted to use liquids because liquids give you the most flexibility in material design. I think of light as a chisel. Light triggers the solidification of the liquid, but oxygen inhibits it. That allows us to have the object grow.
What's really interesting about this collaboration with carbon is we're seeing a convergence of a completely new manufacturing technology.
We're going to scale it with the best industrial partner in the business.
We're able to deliver tens of thousands and moving to hundreds of thousands and into the tens of millions. You know, that's clear in front of us.
We have this amazing opportunity to innovate the printing process, the liquid rising.
And growing in that context can give you new design thoughts you've never had before and new performance capabilities that wouldn't be possible by traditional manufacturing.
This three-dimensional mesh structure, it's a lattice, it's a matrix, it's a web of individual elements. Each one of those little elements is tuned specifically for a purpose.
These lattice structures behave quite differently than anything we've dealt with before. They're much different than foams. Now we have every individual area of the shoe to work with, which is a completely new horizon for us and a new venture.
If you really want to make a shoe that's a size 9, that same shoe for someone who's 180 pounds versus 100 pounds has got to be different.
We can go in within every single cell and engineer that exact cell to do exactly what the consumer needs it to do just for them.
That's fascinating. That's going to change how we create products and certainly how consumers experience products. And I think that's how we see something like Futurecraft 4D playing into the life of an athlete. I would say this is just the very beginning, and you know, it sounds silly and cliche, but yeah, who knows, man? I don't know what's next, and that's what's great about going to work every day.
Footwear manufacturing really hasn't changed over the last 30 years. In fact, if you walked into a factory 30 years ago or you walked into one next week that was making footwear, you'd see essentially the same thing. Every shoe from every brand on the market is created using molds. Shoes are expensive because molds are expensive. What if we created a new process to make shoes without molds? We'd get a lot faster, and we'd change what we make, how we make it, where we make it, and who we make it with. This is the Liquid Factory Lab. It's unlike any other shoe lab anywhere. We're using state-of-the-art manufacturing software and machinery to build a system that literally draws shoes in three dimensions. We had to give our machine something to draw with. That's the liquid part of Liquid Factory, a special high-rebound liquid material made for Reebok by BASF. The bottom of your shoe is called the outsole. It provides traction and durability and hasn't been updated in 30 years. We decided to innovate the outsole with the Liquid Factory process. We had the machines draw in layers, and this allows us to build walls of high rebound material, layer by layer, to create a framework for the shoe. We fill that frame in with a high energy material to create the first ever energy return outsole. It has twice the energy return of a typical rubber outsole. We program the machine to keep drawing and add wings to either side. The wings stretch and mold themselves around your foot as you lace up, giving you a fit like no other shoe. Because it's physically connected to the outsole, you feel the ground in three dimensions. While the Liquid Factory process is completely different, the Liquid Speed shoe is tested exactly the same as every other product we make. Liquid Factory is not just about a new way of making things, it's about a new speed of making things. With Liquid Factory, there are no molds. We can change product almost instantly. But look at product development. This is Liquid Factory, and this is Reebok Future.
In the final video that I just showed you, it was a conglomeration of all the three technologies available, right? In the final process you just saw, the FDM technology was used, also you saw the SLA technology was used, and the SLS technology. So all the three technologies were actually showcased through that. All right, now moving forward, right now what we will do, we will be having a demonstration process, okay, about what 3D printing actually is. So now the thing, as I told you, first step is creating a CAD file. Okay, I will be using a open source software to create a CAD file. I will be designing something, and then I will be transferring that to a slicing software. After that, we will be going for printing. Okay, so let's, I'm exiting that right now. Okay, now the thing is, the software that I'm going to use today will be SketchUp. All right, let me open it up. All right, so this is the interface for SketchUp software. Let me start it up. Okay, the first screen that actually comes up is this, okay. Now see, this box, you see it is a 3D printer size that it is trying to showcase. Now, the advantage of this software is any person can actually learn to use this software. All right, and it is very easy to learn. Like it has got very less amount of tools. You can see this is a very large tool set and almost all the tools are actually covered. So basically any person, if they want to learn about 3D printing, they can use this software. All right, if they have no prerequisite knowledge about designing. Now for 3D printing, you can also go for advanced software like AutoCAD, CATIA and all. But this software, it is very, very easy for any layman to actually understand. Okay, we have been teaching this to many persons, like doctors. We have taught it to doctors. We have taught it to housewife. We have taught it to school going kids also. And they were actually very easily able to grasp it. All right. So let's do one thing. Let's start designing. So let me place that. Okay, now see, these are the axes as I told you, three-dimensional objects. So these are the three axes. I will be designing something over here. So first I've got here 2D tools like line tool, rectangle tool. Let's draw a rectangle over here. Let's go to the top view. Now, what I will try to do is I will create object over here. Let me draw something related to COVID. Okay, so I will try to create a COVID keychain. Okay, a safety keychain that I am trying to design over here. So the thing is, I am creating a customized object as per my requirement. Suppose this is my requirement. Let's touch it over here. Now let's see how it works. Let's delete all the extra lines. There is open space over there. So to connect them, I will be using it. Suppose this is what I've done. Let's delete the inner part. So I will be simply, this is a 2D structure. You see, there is no thickness or anything. It is simply a 2D structure. Using this tool, three-dimensional to push-pull tool, I am pulling it up. As you can see, this is my final structure. So I can print it now. Now let me make some a few more changes over here. Let's do thing for hanging purpose. Let's draw this. Let me pull it out. I can do that also. To give a better look, let me use some arc tools over here. It is going up. I have to remove that. So when that is possible. For pressing buttons of a lift or something, what I will do, I will press a switch over there, like a tool over here. I'm pulling it. Done. So suppose this is my final design. The line would remain. Suppose I want to customize it in my name. I will be also wanting to write my own name. So what I will do, I will place my name over here. Let me type it down. Let's decrease it. I think it is in reverse order. I can also change that. I rotated it. I can move it. I will place it over here. I can decrease the size. So it is a very simple software. Any person can actually learn this, how to use the software. Now that's done. Again, I have to resize it because it is too large as compared to it. Let's increase the size. Let's decrease the height. Now suppose this is the final object that I have created. As I told you, after the designing is done, once the designing is done, what I will do, I have to save the file in the form of STL format. STL format. Now in SketchUp, you can either install a plugin for exporting it in direct to XTL, or there is another option also called exporting the file in DAE format. The slicer software that I'm going to use, it will also understand DAE format. Now what I will do, I will save this file first. Let's save this file in the desktop. Let me save it in the desktop itself so that everyone can actually see. So Anand, that's my name. I'm saving it up. And let me name it Anand Keychain. It's a COVID keychain. That's done. I'm saving it in all right. I think it is. It's not showing, not being exported. Not an issue. Let's do one thing. I have saved this file. Let me right click on it. Let me go to another version, that is 2017 version. Okay, I have a SketchUp 2017 version. So we will get an option for exporting in STL also. All right, not an issue. All right, the 2017 version is up. So I've opened that file using the 2017 version. All right, the file is ready. It will be coming up. I had actually designed it in a 2014 version. Okay, that's it is what it is telling. If I want to change, make some changes, it will be saved in the 2017 version file. Now see, here in 2017 version, I have the plugin installed, Export STL. Okay, I am going to use it in the 2017 version. Let me export it. Okay, now see, I am saving it in the desktop. The format is .stl, the extension I have got already, all right, .stl, I am saving it. Now let's go to the desktop. All right, now see, this is the SketchUp file, the designing file that I made. This is the STL file. This should be saved separately. Okay, now I will be let me first open it. Let me open the slicer software. The name of the slicer software is Cura, C-U-R-A. Okay, C-U-R-A. Now it is an open source slicing software. So suppose the thing is, if you want to make your or add your own machine, okay, you have suppose a custom built machine. So you should actually go for this open source software like Cura. So here you can add all the hardwares actually available. That is the nozzle size, the dimension of your printer and all, you can give that and you can create it. Okay, so it will be very, very advantageous for all those people who are creating their own machines. All right. Also, there are options for adding the machines which are readily available in the market. Okay, you can also do that, that's not an issue. But if you're going for your own printer or the printers available, you can go for slicing software. That is, it is open source that I am talking about. All right. So let's see what it is being loading up. All right, let's wait for a few seconds. Okay, it will take some time. Wait for a few seconds. Okay, it's turned on. All right, you can see in the screen, you are able to see in the box over here. Okay, I think the box is visible. So basically it is the maximum print volume of our printer. Okay, it is the maximum print volume of our printer. Now see, if I want to add a printer, I can also do that. All right, so basically what we do, let me show the printer settings also. Okay, so basically what we give the data, the dimensions of our machines, okay, the bed plate dimensions, okay, these are the data that we actually provide, the number of extruders and all. All right, we give that, the dimension, the nozzle dimension, the material size that we are going to use, all this data we provide in the slicing software. So if the data is having some error, then there will be a issue with the printing quality. All right, so I have selected my machine. All right, so in this method what we do, I will load my file. What I can do, I can simply drag and drop. Okay, I can simply drag and drop is over here. Now my keychain is here. Okay. The next step that I have to do it here is slice. To the right bottom corner, you see there is a button, slice. Okay, let's do that. Okay, it is showing time as well the amount of weight that will be required. Now, the thing is, okay, let me show you this. All right, this is the layer view. Okay, let me zoom it a little bit more. All right, now see, this is what I was talking about. The whole model is actually converted into individual layers. All right. So let me close it out. Now to the right hand side, you can see there is a slider bar, and in the slider bar, there is in the top, it is written 55. So this model is actually made up of 55 layers. All right. Now see, I can actually see the individual layers that are being actually printed. All right, you can see individual layers we can see while it is printing. Okay, so basically this slicing software is actually converting the whole file into a individual layers. Okay, now I think this is a very large model. So what I will do, I will reduce the size first because it is taking 2 hours, right? So let me reduce the time first. Let me make it 50% of the size. Let me see the timing. I think, or maybe it is too long. Okay, it is taking around 24 minutes. All right. So now the thing is, let me show you one more thing. In the preview, we could actually see, okay, let me zoom in again. Right. What settings we can give it over here is the individual things like the outer wall, okay, the inner infill, all this setting we can set it with our own requirement. Okay, the inner part I can also, let me do one thing, can keep the quality as it is. Okay, infill, let me, okay, reduce it is 60%. Suppose let me, I want to keep it to 10% infill, and I'm keeping it as grid. All right, now if you watch carefully, what will happen? The infill pattern will change, okay? And the infill percent is only 10%. See, the amount of infill is reduced to huge extents. I can make my whole object completely hollow. So this is not possible in any other manufacturing technique, and this is only possible through 3D printing. You can make your whole object completely hollow. So let's make it 40% infill. Let's see what are the changes you can see over here. All right, for 40% is already taking up automatically lines. Let's make it grid. All right, so see, for 40%, this is the infill pattern. All right, the infill is 40% and the pattern that we have is grid pattern. So these are the settings that we can actually make in this method in Cura slicing. Let me add one more thing, support, because there is an overhanging part. It will have to create a support. Okay, let me see if there is in support. I think it is actually creating a support. Yes. There are supports are being created over here. Okay, for any overhanging part, we have to create some supports. Now, once it is done, it is ready. Now, what I will do, I will be showcasing you the printer now. Now, let's do one thing. It is ready now. So next thing is printing. All right, let me do one thing. I will be showing my printer now through my mobile phone. So what I will do, let me stop the screen share. All right, in this, I have pinned a video that is from Anand Kumar Mishra. And in the screen, you can see a complete 3D printer. Okay, that is available in our office. And that is the complete parts. Okay, you can see the print head part. Okay, so now the first thing that I will do is I will turn on the printer. Okay, the lights are on. Let me open the doors for you. So from the front view, you can also see the different parts. I have a bed plate actually over there. Okay, and that's the nozzle that you are able to see. All right, that's the nozzle that I was talking about. All right, and then I have a LCD screen. All right, you can see now the LCD screen is there and it is actually showing, okay, that is 27 is the present room temperature. All right, so first command I have to give it to preheat. Okay, that is I have to preheat because I'm going to print something. I will be giving a preheat command, preheat PLA. The target temperature, as you see right now, is 200 degrees Celsius. Okay, and the for bed plate is 70 degrees Celsius. So as my PLA material is actually melting at 200 degrees Celsius, so I am doing that. So let me show you the PLA material. The back of the printer, okay, that is the filament. Okay, you can see that the wire form of the filament, and it is going inside the extruder part. Okay, so basically what happens is this extruder, it will push the filament into the guide pipe. Okay, the guide pipe, it will go into the printhead. Right, this is how the machine works. We are pushing the filament from the back continuously, and the front part, it is actually melting. Okay, it is going through guide pipe. It will melt in the front part, and the deposition will take place. Okay, there will be layer by layer deposition. All right. Now, in my, I will show you this SD card. Okay, I will copy my file in the SD card now. Okay, I will be copying that in my SD card. Okay. So basically what I will do. Okay, the SD card is ready. All right. There are some different files in the SD card, not an issue. Okay. Now I'm copying the SD file. I'm keeping it as CFFP Anand COVID Kitchen. Okay. I'm saving it to file. I'm ejecting it. Okay, done. Now, the file I have transferred to the SD card. Now, the next thing that I will be doing is, okay, I'm inserting the SD card into the designated slot. Now, in the screen, you can see the media inserted. One thing also you can observe is the temperature has already reached 200 degrees Celsius. All right. Now, the next thing I will do, I will give a print command. Print from media. Our first file is my file. COVID keychain. This is what I made just now. It's in the form of G code. I will click on that. I will get the option for printing. Okay. All right. A few changes. The bed plate temperature is asking for 70 degrees Celsius. All right. We can change that. Okay, we can go to tune. For bed, I can set it for 60 degrees because I think for 60 degrees, it is sufficient for PLA. All right. So now it is checking for the temperature of the heated hot end part. Okay, I think I've kept the setting for PETG actually. For it is actually setting for the PETG. So what happens is, for different material, we have to give different setting. Okay, so PLA, we should actually keep it at 200 degrees Celsius. Now it must have started printing. Okay, see, this is the first process. A few amount of material comes out. All right, you can see the print head part is actually moving now. Okay, it is moving and it is depositing the filament. So the melting is going on continuously, and from the backside of the printer, it is pushing the filament. So this is how 3D printing actually was, the FDM method or SDM, solid deposition modeling, or fused deposition modeling, right? And it's a basic technology that I am showing you. Now, as per the requirement of the design, okay, as per the G code that I have made, the tool head or the print head would move and it would deposit the filament wherever it is required. Right, you can see the model. First, it is creating an outline, and then it will fill up the other parts. Okay, the time we just saw was, it was I think around 20 minutes. Okay, so you see, let's wait for a few seconds. The first layer, I think it will be done, and then just above it, another layer will be done. All right, let me wait for a few seconds. Just the filling in has to be done. Once the filling starts, then we will stop the video. And then we will return after the final product is created. All right. Now see, the filling has started, the infill. All right. So the thing is, first the lowermost bottom and the topmost bottom, we are keeping it completely 100% filled because it will be seen to the other customers. So we can change the infill. Okay. See the top bottom portion there, completely filled. So the first layer is completely done now. All right. After the bed plate actually comes down. Okay. So if you want to see the mechanism, what are the motors used? We can show you that. Okay, the stepper motors are in the back. Okay, so basically the stepper motors are the one which are moving it. All right, so we will come back after a few minutes. We will see how the printing is done. All right, so till then I am unpinning it and I am stopping the video. All right, so now in the meanwhile, let's go back and watch our slide, how much we have reached till now. All right, see, it is showing 22 minutes to print. In my screen, you are able to see the time even. It is taking 22 minutes to print. So I think I will return after that. Okay, till then, let's see. Now, let's go back to our slides. So I have designed, and then next I've created a STL file. And then I went for this slicing software. And in the slicing software, I created a G code. Okay, I am using the G code to print now. All right, this is what actually happened right now. So our phase for demonstration is completed. So we will come back to our video a little bit later. So till then, let's look into some different parts. Okay, now let's see. Okay, our this session is completed. So coming to the next session. Now, why is 3D printing actually so important nowadays? So what is the most important thing? Why it is so famous? So why is all the industries, they are utilizing it one by one? So in the screen, you see a different industrial revolutions are shown up. The first industrial revolution actually revolved around the steam engines. Okay, we actually able to control the steam power. So that was all about first industrial revolution. Next, second industrial revolution came up all about mass production. All right. So the third industrial revolution was the onbound of the IT industry or the electronics. Okay. We could decrease the size of the electronic products to a huge extent. Now, the present state, we are in a industry 4.0. All right. Now, it inculcates a lot of things, like not only just additive manufacturing. See, additive manufacturing is part of it, but it is autonomous robots, big data analytics, okay, Internet of Things, cyber security, a lot of things is involved in industry 4.0. So this is the present demand of the industry. Okay, one of them is additive manufacturing. The reason being is it can actually create something which is not actually possible till now, right? As you saw, the designs were very, very complex, right? We were actually 3D print matrix X, right? The matrix were not possible in the beforehand. Okay. 3D technologies are actually increasing the interest in the shoe industry because of the opportunities that are actually offered in terms of personalization. The consumers are looking for unique final products. So the shoe industries are actually moving forward toward this part. All right. Now imagine that suppose in the near future, there is a shoe store. You simply go to the shoe store and you give the size and you give the design. Okay. It's 3D printing your shoe according to your demands. All right. So you can imagine that. Now, this is the very latest data that I am showing you. 74% of the companies plan to invest in 3D printing by 2021. You can see the report is of September 29th of 2020. Okay, now most of the companies, they are highly willing to invest in the 3D printing technology. Now let's talk about the present scenario. Okay, there is a company in India. We must all have seen the Reebok, Adidas and all. So let's look into this. Okay, now the company name is ShapeCrunch. What they do actually is they scan the feet of the person or the required customer. All right, they take the feedback and all, and they create an insole. okay, the 3D print a insole specifically for the customer's requirement. So let me showcase a video about their product. Okay, they are describing how they are actually using it. All right, let's watch that.
Okay, so when we talk about Shape Crunch technology, what are we actually talking about? And it's a 3D graphic technology. The material that the Shape Crunch technology uses is TPU, that is thermoplastic polyurethane. And it's quite wonderful by which they play with the material to give the required relief. For example, we can do a wedging of the heel. It could be a lateral wedging or a medial wedging or whatever. Generally, we provide 6 degrees or 8 degrees. You can go to any degrees you want for the wedging. Secondly, we can give an arch. Then we can give a bump or a metatarsal bar. It can be a through and through bar over the entire metatarsals or a bump or specific metatarsal neck where the problem is. Another thing which we can do is an offloading cavity. Like these are done for the corn and the pressures are offloaded at these cavities. So there are a lot of ways by which we can play to give the required help and relief to
that was the present scenario. Or that was the present scenario. And we have a company which is actually doing that. Okay, we have a company which is actually doing that in India. Now we must have a information that all of these that the all the videos that I just showed was of foreign country, but India has taken up this, and you can actually get it for yourself also. All right, now that was in the meanwhile the printing is going on. Once the printing is done, I will showcase the video also. All right, so over to you, Manish sir.
Yes, just a moment. All right. I think that was an informative session which talked about how 3D printing technology can be used in the footwear industry. We did receive a lot of questions, but most of them were in the private chat section. So many of us were not able to see the questions. So this is the right time. If you have any questions, we can take up those questions and the speaker directly can answer that. And in just about say 5 or 10 minutes, we will be able to show you the actual 3D print that is being printed right now. So in the next 10 minutes, you will be able to see the design that got printed. So if there are any questions, I can unmute any person if you want to directly ask the speaker, and we'll be really happy to take those questions.
If you want to ask something directly, you can unmute yourself. Let me turn on the option. Okay, I'm allowing the participant to unmute herself, so you can unmute yourself and you can ask a question. All right, not an issue.
Hello, good afternoon, sir.
Okay, good afternoon, sir. Hello? Please go ahead.
Sir, I want to ask, like TPU material you are telling, sir, like it's used in 3D printing, sir. So like any specific temperature required for that, sir? TPU, sir. How much temperature is required for that? For that melting purpose, right, see, for the molds and all that. To get the upper shape.
Yeah. In FDM method that we use for 3D printing TPU, we basically keep it at around 240 to 250 degrees Celsius for melting the TPU. All right. The printer that you just saw, the hot end, it is the one which is at 200 degrees for PLA. And for TPU, we have to keep the hot end at around 240 to 250 degrees.
And sir, one more thing, sir. So like any surrounding temperature we have to maintain, like for only machine is required, sir, like room temperature, any other things surrounding like that is.
While printing TPU and all, the thing is we have to keep a heated bed plate also. Okay, the bed plate on which it is printing, we have to keep the bed plate also at some certain degree, 70 to 80 degrees, all right? We have to do that. Also, if it is better always to keep the printer, the printing bed plate is an enclosed chamber. Okay, the printer that I just showed you, it is having a door and it is enclosed in the left and right. So basically, this is a printer for ABS material also, TPU material also, and PLA material also. PETG, all right, the different materials we can print here. So we have to keep it in that way. Okay, we have to keep a enclosed chamber. The heated bed is sufficient.
Sir, any Indian brands have opted this, sir, like this part, sir? 3D printing parts, any Indian brands?
Oh, I don't have any data regarding that. I hope there is a lot of research going on. The only company that I got you for is ShapeCrunch. So they are creating insoles, 3D printed insoles actually. Okay, okay. You can put the insole inside shoe that you already have and you can use that.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I've got one query from Virat, sir. Okay. As printing method reduces a lot of work and use of manpower. Okay. See, it is actually what if you see the traditional method of manufacturing through mold method. So it requires a lot of manpower because the molds they are created and they are to be handled. All of machining has to be done. So as compared to that, the manpower required in 3D printing is very low. Okay, after printing also, we have to go through some post processing. Okay, we have to use some post processing tools, but the manpower we have to only grow our skill set. We have to only grow our skill set for 3D printing, and any person can actually use these 3D printing skills. All right, because we have actually trained as housewife, school going kids even. So we have trained a lot of different wide range of people. All right, so any person can actually get skilled in this technology. Not an issue with that.
Absolutely wonderful questions. In fact, there were a couple of questions, Anand, that came on the chat. I'll just highlight those questions. So one of the participants...
I've got another query also.
Yeah, so you can take yours and then I'll ask you the next question, please.
All right. The first thing that query that comes up is, does 3D printing is cost effective nowadays in the Indian footwear industry? And among additive and subtracting methods, which is the most reliable in daily use? So see, there are two things. Either you can go for mass production of the same design, or you can go for mass customization. So if the customer's requirement is for a customized person, his or own design that has to be made, or there is some problem in his fields, right? There is flat full problem. So they have to go for additive manufacturing. All right. Now, if you want a mass production of any same design, okay, you want to create, a million shoes of a single design. So in that case, you have to go for mass production, that is in subtractive manufacturing method through molds and all. All right. Is 3D printing cost effective in the Indian footwear industry? Now see the shape cross that I just showed you. For special people who have special requirements, the cost is, I think, around 2000 rupees to 3000 rupees for the insoles, right? So the cost is slowly reducing day by day as per the requirements. All right, Abhishek, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, Manish, sir, over to you.
One of the questions that has come down is from the name of the participant is not clear because they must have logged in using a mobile phone, maybe. So the question is, how significant is 3D printing in the footwear industry? Like Anand did show a lot of examples from the medical sector, from the automotive sector, from different sectors, right? So Anand, the question is, what are your thoughts on how this technology in the footwear section is going to develop in India? Like, what is the current state? You mentioned ShapeCrunch is one of the companies. Can we look up to, you know, more of such companies that are into footwear? That's the question.
Yes, of course, definitely, because the designs that can be actually made and the requirements of the people is increasing day by day. Now, as I told you, one example I gave was we actually give personalized gift to people, okay, because we get a connection with that. Now, every people have some requirements for their footwear, right? We search a lot on the internet regarding buying a shoe, okay, the design and all. What if we just think that I want a design, okay? I want my own design and my own 3D printed shoe. So their companies are actually trying to invest in this idea, that is customization, okay? So if the customer is actually requiring that product, even the companies, they are trying to invest more in 3D printing right now. All right, as I told you, the three technologies that was available, SDM, SLS and SLA. So the whole shoe can now be even 3D printed, the outer part, different design, all are being trying to be done in India also, okay? All right, over to you, Manish, sir.
All right, great. Anand, can you please confirm us if how much percentage of the file has been 3D printed now? Or
okay, okay. Let me do one thing. Let me stop the screen share now. Okay, let's go to the. Okay, now I'm pinning my video. I will pin my video. Okay. I think everyone is able to see the screen. I forgot to unpin that. Okay.
Yes, the screen is visible to me. If anyone of you is unable to view this printer, you can let us know and we'll do something.
Okay. So basically, 90% was completed.
Mm-hmm.
And the final layers are being printed right now. You can see. The nozzle is moving according to our G code that we have actually created, and it is depositing the plastic material. This is PLA, not TPU. Polylactic acid is the raw material. TPU is highly elastic. The ones which we use like in the mobile phone covers, right? That is TPU actually. Mostly done. Let me see the percentage here. If you see that, the percentage is almost 94%. Okay, 94% of our model has been 3D printed. Okay, 95% now. I think this is the final layer, according to me. Okay, so after this layer, the complete model will be ready. Okay,
right.
Once the model is ready, I will be waiting for a few seconds for the heated bed to cool down. Then I can remove my model. All right, everyone.
Right, right. Anand, can you stop the, or I'll just stop the highlight. I'd like to show one model to the participants.
Let me stop the video right now. Okay, let me stop the video in my mobile phone.
All right. So
I've done that.
One of the videos, I'll just show one of the designs. So this was designed here at the facility of 3Dexter. It's just a small design of a shoe. And you can see it's a very comfortable shoe. This is not printed out of the TPU material that we earlier said. We wanted to see if the design comes out properly. But the same design can be printed in TPU and can be flexible. These lays, as you can see, this is the filament, the translucent filament that we use. So this filament can be used to print the main body of the shoe. And you can possibly use it for varied applications. One of the examples of what Anand was reiterating on the different kinds of designs that you can come up with for the footwear industry, right? Anand, you can take over.
All right. So my final product is almost ready. So I am letting it to cool down. I will remove it up and I will... All right. Let me wait for a few seconds. Okay, I am actually, my sir is over here, Rahul sir. Okay. Okay, let me show it to you on my mobile phone.
All right, I have spotlight the small file. So you can see, I think, Anand, you can take over, please.
Okay. So this is the file. See, this is the advantage of 3D printing. I simply designed something before you. I think that was half an hour before. So within 13 minutes, my product is ready. Okay, you can understand. I designed it in front of you. I sliced it in Cura. And within 30 minutes, my product is ready. So suppose this is a prototype. And I can do all sort of testing. If I want to sell this, I can also do that. So now thing is, any kind of the complex design can be done through this. Okay, you can see the final product is over in front of you. This is a COVID keychain. Okay, let me, I think that my name is not visible. Let me show that first. Okay, you can see I have made a customized design. I'm missing, my name is visible to all.
Right, I think it's white in color. That's the reason why it's not being focused. But I believe the outer boundary of the name is visible, I think, to most people.
Yes, I think the boundary is, I think, visible now. So I made a customized product with my name. All right. So that is a huge advantage of 3D printing. Well, I can create any product according to my requirement. Suppose I want to make a mobile phone cover. Now I know my requirements, my mobile phone holder. I know my requirements. Suppose I want to make a stand, which has the ability for charging slots and all. It has to have a also arrangement. So I can incline the phone while I'm watching a video. So all these factors I can keep in mind. I create a product for my own needs. Okay. This is like democratization of your ideas. Okay. Now, this is what I'm talking about. 3D printing. Okay.
Anyone
can create your own ideas and you can 3D print them.
Right.
Okay.
I believe right now. Absolutely, Anand. Thank you. All right. So I believe that session, this particular session witnessed the process of 3D printing and how it can be utilized in the footwear industry. This entire webinar that we are currently hosting on Zoom, and we have extended the same streaming to YouTube as well. This wouldn't have been possible without the immense support from the Footwear Design and Development Institute. I would like to specifically name Mr. Prashant Kumar Saxena, who is the head of the department at the Footwear Department, some senior faculty members, sincere acknowledgments to the FTDI Pursadganj campus members, Mukesh Saini sir, Manoj Roy sir, and Garima Kakkar. who have been a constant support in setting up the entire premise for this webinar. I personally believe that this particular webinar would have given you a little bit of an introduction of what 3D printing is and how it has helped develop a perspective. I think one of the participants, Mr. Rajesh, has asked for a query.
I have a query about we have used one color. If we have two color or three color, is there possibility in the 3D printing, or we have to apply two or three more heads? And is there possibility for two color or three color products?
All right. I'll ask Anand to take up that question. Anand, would you like to take?
Sure, sir.
Okay.
In FDM technology, that the one just I showed you right now, the live demonstration, we will be using the nozzle. Okay, we can have multiple nozzles from where we can use multiple color of, we can create multicolored object also. All right, sir. So it is known as a dual extruder or multiple extruders we have to attach, and we can use that for 3D printing in multiple colors. Now, for what polymerization method, there is a method known as binder jetting or material jetting. So in that, they are spraying the resin. Okay, the resin, which was actually photopolymer material, which converted into solid while exposure to UV ray. So that resin we can use in binder jetting or material jetting method. So what they do, they have a nozzle, they spray the material. Okay, and as soon as the material drops on the object or the bed plate, the UV ray, it passes over it and solidifies it. Now in there, we can have multiple tanks of the different colors, and using multiple tanks, we can create a multicolor object. All right, this is the advantage in binder jetting. The process is mostly similar to the what photopolymerization method that I just showed you. We use a photopolymer method. All right, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Manishji, for coordinating it so well. And this is Garima Kakkar, Senior Faculty in FTDI and the co-coordinator of this huge event, huge knowledgeable event. I'm very thankful to Mr. Anand for sharing such knowledgeable thoughts to our students and faculty members and giving an insight that how this 3D printing is important in footwear industry. Because new technology coming in and making its path, it's very important for our students to know those things. I'll extend my thanks to Mr. Manish Nair, the operation manager and the co-coordinator and question putter of the event and clarifying all the things. And Mrs. Meenakshi, the coordinator of the event, and your entire team of 3D Extra. You people have actually created a brighter vision in our students' point of view and clarified how this new technology is paving a path in footwear industry. Thank you very much for the wonderful session.
Thank you very much, Garima ma'am, for those kind words. So Rishabh Shukla has asked for a question. Rishabh, either you can unmute yourself or you can write the question on the chat box, whichever way you wish to take it up. We'll be really happy to address your query.
Hello, sir.
Hello, Rishabh. Please go ahead.
Sir, I have a question. Can we decide number of layer which are actually possible? Sir, that the key has 55 layers. So is that possible that we can subtract the layers, number of layers?
Okay, yes, sir. Actually, the thing is, we can decide the layer height even. Okay, there are, suppose a object is of 10 millimeter. Okay, now we can decide the layer height to be 1 mm. Okay, if there is 1 mm layer height, so there will be 10 layers printed. Now, if I keep the layer height 2 mm, suppose for example, then there will be 5 layers printed. Okay. Now layer height, it depends upon the nozzle diameter that we give. We can keep a 0.4 diameter nozzle, 0.6. Okay, there are variety available. So according to nozzle diameter, we can also set the layer height. All right. So the less the layer height and more the number of layers, the surface quality will be good. Okay. If we are decreasing the number of layers and the layer thickness, you are keeping it more, the quality of the surface will be less. Okay, that means the layer thickness and the quality both are inversely proportional.
All right, great. If any one of you has any more questions, you can please do ask, because this is a platform where you can ask any questions that is related to 3D printing and whatever you learned in today's session.
Hello, sir.
Yes, please go ahead.
Good afternoon, sir. This is Arvind Kumar. Sir, मुझे ये जानना है जैसे हम 2D printing में color to
Hello, is it audible for everyone? I'm not sure if it's audible from my side.
Okay, even I could not hear the audio.
Okay.
So I think the question was about in 2D printing, we can color the object. Whether can we, while designing, can we color our 3D printed model? I think that was the question.
Arvind, your voice, aapki awaaz beech mein break ho gaya tha. तो आप दोबारा पूछ सकते हैं।
ओके सर, सर जैसे 2D प्रिंटिंग में हम कलर ब्लेंडिंग का ऑप्शन आता है, जैसे हम प्रिंट करते हैं तो कलर ब्लेंड होता है, तो क्या ये इसमें पॉसिबल है 3D में?
As I told you, this is also for creating multicolored objects, right? We use a single color for FDM technology. Now in binder jetting that I told you for what photopolymerization method, we can do that, the color blending, okay, for binder jetting method.
And similarly, iske andar main aapko ek aur cheez batana chahunga. Very recently in the research of 3D printing materials, ek khas tarike ka category of materials, jise kehte hain phase change materials, ye upon एप्लीकेशन आप या तो हीट के एप्लीकेशन से नहीं तो फिर कोई यूवी लाइट के एप्लीकेशन से इन मटेरियल्स के फेसेस चेंज हो जाते हैं. तो इस तरीके के मटेरियल्स भी आजकल 3D प्रिंटिंग में रिसर्च किया जा रहा है और वो यूज़ में आ रहा है आराम आराम से. तो आई बिलीव इस तरीके के जो मटेरियल्स जो प्रॉपर्टीज चेंज करते हैं एट सर्टेन टेम्परेचर कंडीशंस और मे बी हीट एप्लीकेशंस, उस तरीके के एप्लीकेशंस में ये जो फेस चेंज मटेरियल्स हैं दैट विल फाइंड अ वेरी गुड फिट फॉर एप्लीकेशंस इन दी लेट्स से फुटवेयर और मे बी एनी अदर एप्लीकेशन. तो मटेरियल्स एक ऐसा एरिया है जहाँ पे बहुत ही अच्छे तरीके से रिसर्च जारी है. प्लस जो आपने अभी पूछा, जो अभी आनंद सर ने भी बताया, जो प्रिंटर्स आप जिन प्रिंटर्स में आपको मल्टीपल कलर्स चाहिए होते हैं प्रिंट्स में, वो या तो आपके बाइंडर जेटिंग मशीन्स होते हैं, नहीं तो आप एग्जिस्टिंग टेक्नोलॉजी जो आपका FDM 3D प्रिंटर है उसमें आप डुअल नोजल का इस्तेमाल कर सकते हैं, जिसमें कि सिर्फ एक नोजल नहीं होगा, दो होगा, या फिर आप तीन नोजल भी लगा सकते हैं, ट्रिपल नोजल हो जाएगा. सो इन सच केसेस आपके पास ऑप्शन होगा नॉट जस्ट इन वन कलर बट आप थ्री डिफरेंट कलर्स यू कैन यूटिलाइज इट इन दैट वन पर्टिकुलर प्रिंट एंड यू कैन यूज इट विच एवर वे यू वॉन्ट. तो देर आर मल्टीपल वेज इन विच यू कैन सी दिस पर्टिकुलर problem, right?
Okay. I have another query from Virat sir. He is asking that the components used in manufacturing as top off and counter stiffeners are still in use. So what are used in place of that? Now see sir, now suppose now think in this way, a product that you are making, they are made of suppose a three or more different parts, okay, like top off and counter stiffeners, all that, they're different parts. Now in 3D printing you have got an advantage, you can make the complete design by attaching all of them together, okay. So basically we are using the work that was done by the top off and counter stiffener, and the complete insole or complete midsole is functioning as the actually doing the work of this stiffeners and top off, right? So we can make the design in such a way the work is there, the whole design is created in a single piece, not multiple piece, but a single piece can work a multiple works. All right.
All right, great. So are there any more questions? If anybody wishes to ask any more questions, we can take those. Or else I believe we have reached towards the end of the particular webinar. So we'll wait for another 1 minute maybe if there are any more questions, or else in other case we'll close this meeting, end this meeting.
Yes, Abhishek sir has able to 3D super and the bottom. Yes, there are companies which have already 3D printed the complete whole suit together. All right, the whole suit can be 3D printed completely together. And there are companies they have already done that. I think I had shown one video. Let me show that. The slide, I think I had one in SLA, I think.
Yes, sir, but it is comfortable for a person to wear that kind of shoe in the seat.
Yes, of course. See, as I told you, we are taking into consideration the demands of the customer. Okay, according to his shoe feet requirements, we are creating a shoe. Okay, the needs of the customer are actually required here, fulfilled here. See here, this is what I was telling. This is a whole shoe that has been completely 3D printed. All right, the top, I think this is the greenish blue part. Okay, so while designing it, suppose what we do, we take the data from the shoe, data from the person's feet, and using the data, we actually make the shoe. Okay.
So, sir, actually, it depends on person to person needs and skin.
Exactly. This is what I was talking about, customization. As I told, so if a one person's need is different, we will be creating a shoe that would be completely fitting to his foot, and the requirements of that customer is actually fulfilled. Now for any different person, the requirement will be completely different, right? That is customized for that person, right? So this is known as mass customization. Okay, so for different person, we are catering the different needs of different person. All right.
Okay, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
Exactly.
All right. I believe that was an informative session for all the participants who joined from FDDI. Thank you very much once again to the entire management of Footwear Design and Development Institute. There has been an immense support from the back end, starting from the coordinator till the final person who was supposed to take care of the operations while the session was taking place. So thank you very much, everyone who has been part of this session. Now I'll be ending this session. If there are any more queries or questions, I believe you have got the contact details or the email address that you need. If you have any questions, we'll be really happy to answer those questions on email as well. Thank you, everyone. Wish you a good day ahead and all the best. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.